And we have lots and lots of other programs too. You saw a lot of them up on the slides. But I will highlight a few here. March 10th, this Saturday, we have Saturday Sketch. And it is an hour of free art instruction and advice. And we always have a different artist every month. And you can come and bring your sketching materials, and they can give you advice, you can ask questions. And so this month we have Eric Clausen. So come in from 10 to 11 during our free time, and take advantage of that. And on the 14th, next Wednesday, Munchler is going to be our own director, Kevin Sharp. Wave everybody, Kevin. He has graciously stepped in, sort of at the last minute to do that, so we're really glad to have him. And next Thursday, March 15th, we have a very busy, fun night. It's open late, and our own Voice Theater Troupe is going to be here doing Pick a Painting Improv. And so, if you would like to sort of see sort of a different take on our painting, see them kind of come to life, then come for that. That's from 6 to 8. And we also have our Dixon Book Club. And Joyce Ann, wave to everybody. She is the facilitator, that's Joyce Ann Gardner, for the book club. And you guys will be discussing Lab Girl. And we also have Sunset Yoga. And so there will be something that you'll have fun doing this coming Thursday night next week. And so Sunset Yoga is from 6:30 to 7:30. But today, we're really, really lucky to have our very own Julie Perotti. And she earned her master's at Vanderbilt. She was Phi Beta Kappa, so very, very smart lady, of course. And she started her career here at Dixon in 2007. And she actually started as a curatorial assistant, then became assistant curator, then curator, and now is the Martha R. Robinson curator. So nothing can slow her down. Please help me welcome Julie Perotti.
Thanks, Lindley. Okay, thank you all for coming today. This is a great crowd. I'm so excited. And I hope you all have been into the exhibition already, to The Real Beauty, the Artistic World of Eugenia Arasuriz. If not, please do so after Munch and Learn. And I hope you all either have enjoyed or will enjoy learning about the Arasuriz and Super Peso families as much as I have over the past 5.5 years. So we'll get going. The Dixon Sardis, which is this painting on the screen, all of you long-term Dixonians, as I like to call our long-term members, y'all know it's one of our most loved paintings. What I really don't ever talk about is it's one of our most requested paintings from other museums. Like, if other museums are putting exhibitions together, just like the Eugenia show, you borrow works of art from other museums, and the Sargent is one of the paintings in our collection that gets a lot of requests. So I thought it would be fun today to do kind of a deep dive into this painting and to the subject of the painting, since him, Ramon, and his family are a big part of the of Eugenia's story. So, yeah, these two paintings, of course, our Sargent and our Blanche, are the starting points for the exhibition, for The Real Beauty. When we were considering buying the Blanche back in 2012, one of the many deciding factors, one of the many things that kind of convinced us that the Blanche was a perfect painting for the Dixon, was that, and this was kind of just a coincidence, that Eugenia and Ramon were brother and sister-in-law. So, just to show you, we have a family tree in the exhibition to show you how people are connected, but I thought this would be helpful too. So, Eugenia is married to Jose Tomas Arasuriz, who in my head I say, yeah, they're brother and sister-in-law, but it kind of helps to know who is related to who. And it's been a really fun and really unique opportunity through the exhibition to reunite the portraits of, and the paintings of husband and wife through this exhibition. These are paintings that haven't been together in the same collection in several decades and probably never will be again. It's a really unique opportunity to kind of think of them, think of these pictures, go into the gallery and think of them as, you know, works of art that were in one family's collection. And I think that's really special. And a thing that I hope y'all will appreciate when you're in the exhibition. So here's Ramon when he was a little boy, when he was 10 years old. He was born in 1854 in Valparaiso in Chile into a family that was involved in politics. They were, his father was kind of a politician and a diplomat, but also had an interest in art. And his father had an interest in painting and really kind of passed that on to Ramon especially. So when he is a young man, he takes the grand tour of Europe when he's about 20 years old and really falls in love. So he goes to England and Spain and Italy and France and everywhere a young man of his class would travel and falls in love with all the art that he sees there and ultimately going to go back there. And I think once he goes back to Chile, he's kind of changed a little bit and is looking for ways, looking for opportunities to go back to Europe. So after he marries Amalia Errázuriz on June 30th, 1879, this is just as Chile is entering the War of the Pacific. So it's kind of a good time to be leaving Chile, basically. So he and Amalia leave in February of 1880. Actually, they're leaving for a couple of reasons. It's kind of like a honeymoon for them. They go to leave Chile to go to Paris. But also, Ramon is going to be serving as a diplomat of sorts and helping negotiate some business with Chilean coal mines, which is a business that Amalia's father was involved in. So he's kind of going for several reasons. But they leave, and it's all in, actually, I always bring my kind of like bibliography with me to these mention learns, and we're really lucky that Ramon wrote his memoirs. Actually, both of them did. Ramon's are a little bit easier to get a hold of, and it's called Memorias de 80 años, so Memorias of 80 years. And he writes all of this down, like it's basically like a travel journal. And it's really interesting. It was really interesting to look through and figure out kind of the journey they make. They go from Santiago to Buenos Aires to Montevideo, and then they get on a German ship and go to Bordeaux. And then from Bordeaux, they go up to Paris. So they arrive in Paris in February of 1880. By May of that year, they're really comfortable, kind of settled in there. And they go, like thousands upon thousands of other people, to the Paris Salon that year. So all of y'all know that the Paris Salon is the official place for work, an artist's work to be shown in Paris. And the Salon of 1880 was the largest salon that had ever been staged. There were 7,289 entries. So this is kind of the sculpture court, but you can see up here in the second level, all of the paintings that are like crammed in there. And here's another painting of the Salon of 1880. So you can see, you know, the way that the paintings are installed, but also, you know, all of the people that had gone there. And people flocked to see works by the greatest artists that are working in Paris at the time, including Edouard Manet and Renoir. So of all of the works, 7,289 works, the work and the artist whose work made the most powerful impression on Ramon and Amalia Subercaseaux was John Singer Sargent. So at this point, Sargent is about, I think he's like a year Sargent had just kind of come onto the scene the year before through his portrait of his teacher, his kind of mentor, Carol S. Duran. And in 1880, he had two paintings at the Salon that year. The first one is this one, Fumée dans le gris. And both Ramon Sugrocesso and Romalia write about the painting in their memorias as the kind of impetus for them seeking Sargent out and making friends with Sargent. So this painting is inspired by and started in Morocco, and Sargent finishes it in Paris, and it was described by critics as a perfect piece of painting and just really highly praised by critics that year. And both of them just fell in love with it, and the way that Sargent is able to, you know, show so many tones of white in the painting, I think that made a really big impression on them. But they also saw his other painting at the Salon that year, which is this portrait of Madame Pierron. Marie Pierron is married to Edouard Pierron, who was a poet and a writer in Paris at the time. So remember their name, it's going to come back up. But they saw the portrait and loved it and decided kind of right away that he was the artist that they wanted to seek out, to get to know, and to ultimately commission him for a portrait of Amalia. So I love that they do that. They see this artist's work, they kind of, you know, find out where he is, and they go to his studio, which this isn't where it is today, with the aim of commissioning a portrait of Amalia. So through this portrait, they get to be, this really kind of is the start of their friendship, the friendship between the Supercassos and Sargent, and it will last for decades and lead to the exchange of countless works of art, so it's very important. And Sargent really has to start on painting this work, or at least blocking it out right away. Amalia's in her first trimester. She's at the end of her first trimester of pregnancy at this time, so he kind of, any delay, if they waited any longer, we'd be talking about a different portrait. So he gets going, and Amalia writes in her diaries, in her memorias, that she really enjoyed sitting for him. The sittings took place at the Supercassos' apartment in Paris, and they had this piano, and he encouraged her to play while she sat for him, and she says she played pieces by Louis Moreau Gottschalk, who was an American composer, and really enjoyed getting to know him through the sittings. So he'll kind of finish it later, but he gets going on it right away. This is the early summer of 1880. In the meantime, at the same time, Ramon is working on painting himself. He will be a constant painter his whole life. At this point, he's just kind of toying with painting, and he's getting better at it. He's kind of practicing painting, and it's through Sargent that his work will really get better the closer he becomes to Sargent. So he paints Amalia at the piano, and then he paints her, you know, another time standing up. This one actually has a date of July 12, 1880. So you can see just the beginning of a baby bump, I guess. And this one's in the exhibition. It's kind of funny to see it this big because it's, you'll see it in the show, it's like this big, just a little sketch. So through the portrait, like I said, Sargent and the Supercassos become friends, and by the fall of 1880, they're such good friends that they decide to meet up in Venice. Sargent had was traveling there with his family, and after his family left, Sargent stayed in Venice, and that's when the Supercassos came, and they kind of hung out together. They spent the whole fall together. Sargent and Ramon shared a studio here at the Teatro Monaco, which if you go to Venice today, is the Museum of 18th Century Art. But at the time, it was this kind of, had been converted into artist studios. So they took a little studio there. This is a painting that Sargent did in the interior of the building. And so you can see the kind of the bell incidentally, this was owned by Carmen Arazarriz, Eugenia's daughter, later on. So while they're working together that fall, and this is the fall of 1880, Sargent paints two images of Ramon Subercaseaux. This is the first one. It's on loan to us from the St. Louis Art Museum, and it's really great. I hope y'all will take advantage of the flashlights that we put next to the painting, because otherwise you can't see the inscription up here. It says, Madame Subercaseaux, homage to John S. Sargent. So to Madame Subercaseaux, gift of John Sargent. So at this point, Amalia is at the beginning of her last trimester of pregnancy. Keep that in mind. So I think this could have been like a gift from one friend to another at a special moment in their lives. So Sargent not only is so good at capturing the physical likeness of his sitters, isn't this amazing how close they are? And I don't know the exact date of this photograph, but it had to have been somewhere kind of close to the time. But it's like it's an exact copy. It's really interesting. But he does get, I think, a little bit the personality. You feel a little bit of the personality of his sitter. And he does have this air of distinction to him, but at the same time seems like a kind and sympathetic man. So the other painting that Sargent does of Ramon that fall is this one. It's Ramon Subercaseaux in a gondola. Of course, it's out of the Dixon's painting. And it's such a beautiful and remarkable painting for so many reasons. It's unique in Sargent's career that he would be simultaneously the creator of a work of art and the subject of a work of art. So we're sitting in Sargent's, we as the viewer in Sargent's position on the other side of this gondola. So they would go on these little sketching excursions, floating in the canals of Venice in their little gondola and painting what they see. And Sargent is painting Ramon, who is at the same time painting Sargent. The detail that he gets out here, and sometimes it's almost, you pay attention to those details even a little more when you're looking at a digital version of it. I think that's kind of weird to say, but there's so many things I didn't notice until I looked at a really great photograph of it, like the man, the gondoliers back here. I didn't notice for a long time the kind of glint of the buckles of his shoes and things like that. I also, and everybody loves the way the light kind of filters onto these buildings back here. And I always say when I give tours of this, stop in front of this painting on tours, it's like if you touch the water on the painting, and you wouldn't touch it, but if you did, when you pulled your finger away, it would be wet. That's how convincing I think the water is. So what they would do that fall is go on these little sketching trips and take in the sights and the sounds and the smells of Venice and record them on paper. So here's some of Ramon's watercolors that he created, would have created on just such a little sketching trip as the one in here. I love this one. It's great. So a lot of people ask about the reverse of the painting, like where is Ramon's painting of Sargent? Well, the answer is it's been lost, basically. But there is a little bit of a kind of a mystery surrounding this painting. This is a painting that Sargent did in Capri in 1878. It entered the Subercaseaux's collection probably around the same time that they got to know him. And on the back of this painting is this image. So it's an image of a painting of a man in a gondola in a boat, painting in a boat, in a bowler hat, just like Ramon. So is this the reverse? Is this Ramon's painting? I don't know. I don't think so. The family, the Subercaseaux family, has kind of maintained that it was a watercolor, which makes sense from looking at our painting, and that it was lost when a family member who had the watercolor got a divorce, and I think the non-family member spouse got the painting, and it's kind of been lost since then. So that's kind of unfortunate, but it is kind of fun to put them side by side and kind of is this really what he's working on, or is this something that happened later?
Oh, and you know, another work of art that I haven't really talked about yet is this one. This is called Head of a Reclining Void, and this was a gift from Sargent to the Supercassos, but it has now been lost, and it was done in Venice that fall. So you can barely see up here the inscription to, I think it says, to my friend Supercasso, John S. Sargent. And then we have for y'all, after the Supercassos and Sargent kind of parted ways, at the end, I think it's the beginning of December of 1880, the Sargent will stay in Venice for a little bit longer, and the Supercassos go on to Rome, where Amalia will give birth to their son, to their first child, and Ramon will keep painting while he's there. He paints several images of people while he's there, including this one, which I really like, Balcony in Rome. And these are, I think, Commedia dell'arte figures, like little actors. But they'll go back to Paris by the spring of 1881, where the portrait of Amalia is being shown at the Salon that year. And not only is it shown at the Salon that year, it receives a second-class medal, which is a big deal for Sargent, because from that point forward, he will not have to submit his paintings, his work, to the Salon jury. They'll just get kind of automatically accepted. And it gets all kinds of great reviews as and described as a beautiful painting. But there was a little drama that surrounded it. So initially, of course, the medal for the second class medal for Sargent was put on this painting. But for a while, I don't even know how long, for a short period during the Salon, the medal was transferred to this painting, which was Sargent's other submission to the Salon that year, The Children of Edouard and Marie Pailleron, the woman whose portrait they had seen, the Supercassos had seen just the year before. Apparently, Edouard Pailleron, who was very influential at the time, had claimed outrage that a portrait of a foreigner would receive a medal over a portrait of native French children. And somebody actually said, oh, you're right, yeah, I'll move the medal. I guess thinking nobody would know, I don't know. But the Supercassos were very upset about it, and but they found a friend in Jean-Charles Cazin, who was a kind of an academic painter, landscape painter, and he had the medal restored to the portrait of Amalia. So I guess all's well that ends well. But I think the Supercassos were kind of burned a little bit by what happened. Then go back to Chile, pretty not too long after the Salon that year. And that kind of starts the rest of their life. Basically, the rest of their life will be them going back and forth from Europe to Chile. And they'll go for kind of a couple of years in Chile, and they'll come back to Paris for 5 or 6 years, and then they'll go back to Chile, and then they'll come back to Europe. But all the while he's in, while he's back in Chile, he keeps painting and does a bunch of different kinds of works of art. He does landscapes and these kind of, you know, like the harbor views of Valparaiso, and then he'll do still life. He kind of experiments with a little bit of everything. He also gets involved in establishing official art exhibitions in Santiago. So he's kind of organizes basically a version of the Salon in Santiago. So by 1887, I think at the beginning, late 1886, early 1887, they're heading the Supercassos, who now have like, in a short span of time, have a lot of children. They have like 5 kids, I guess, at this point. Go back to Paris. And at this point, Sargent's pretty much out of Paris. And he, when they're looking for artist friends or people to commission for portraits, they turn at this point to Giovanni Boldini, who's an Italian painter that's living in Paris and knew Sargent. So he probably kind of made the introduction. Sargent probably made the introduction to Boldini for the Supercassos. And they kind of click with him right away, just like they had with Sargent, and become really good friends of his. So pretty much right away in 1887, Boldini does us two portraits for the Super Cassos. One is this pastel portrait of Amalia that is now, unfortunately, has been lost. But you can see how beautiful it is and how beautiful she still is. She looks good for having had as many kids as she had. I hadn't thought about that. But they also do this portrait. He also does this portrait of the Super Queso's two oldest children, Luis and Pedro. And what I really love about this is, and it's interesting to look at both of these done at the same time, that in this portrait of the boys, he doesn't feel the need to have the kind of like drama and airbrushing that he does in the portrait of Amalia. And I don't mean airbrushing, but kind of a little bit. That it's this real kind of honest depiction of youth. They have these really kind of they have the look on their face that I feel like my son has on his face all the time. This kind of like. And they've got something to, you know, Pedro will become a really successful painter in Chile, and at the time he was just sketching an image of a ship just to kind of occupy himself while he's sitting for the portrait, and I feel like that inclusion is really honest as well. Pedro later on in his life will make a copy after the portrait of the image of him in the portrait by Boldini. I think it's kind of cute. And then Ramon made this little drawing of Pedro a few years later. Actually, thanks to Ramon and Amalia commissioning Boldini to create those two portraits, Boldini will become the portraitist of choice for all the wealthy Chilean expatriates living in Paris, most of whom are either related to Ramon or Amalia. So this woman, Emiliana Conte de Osa, is Ramon's cousin, and Boldini creates this portrait of her. It's now called Il Pastello Bianco, or the white pastel. But when Boldini showed this at the 1889 Exposition Universelle in Paris, it won a gold medal and became a really very popular, successful painting for Boldini, and really kind of cemented his status as a great portrait artist. While they're back in Europe, Ramon will keep painting and keep making friends with some of the greatest artists that are working in Paris at the time, including Rodin. Rodin has this great history with Chilean patrons. He had shown his work at the Chilean embassy in Paris earlier in the 1880s, but toward the middle of the decade, he receives this commission from Ramon's cousin, Carlos Morla, to create a monument to General Lynch, who was a Chilean general, to be installed in Santiago, in Chile. And this is the maquette for the monument. The actual monument was destroyed before it was able to be installed in Santiago, but they do have the maquettes for it. And they also, Ramon's cousin, Ramon and his cousin, commissioned this bust. This was Ramon's aunt, Madame de Cunha, from Rodin, and now this bust is part of the Musée d'Orsay collection. So when they went to his studio to kind of check on the progress of this, Ramon and Amalia know, and they bring along their siblings, José Tomás and Eugenia Errázuriz. And Eugenia sees this sculpture by Rodin in his studio and becomes, you know, just falls in love with it instantly, and buys it from Rodin. And it's in the show now. Another painter that Ramon Super Queso becomes close with is Pascal Damian-Bucaré, who was, an academic painter. And he commissions, Ramon commissions this painting from his friend, Madonna of the Trellis. And this one actually just went up for auction a couple of years ago. It's really large, but it's really beautiful. And he worked with Ramon a lot and kind of helped him refine his style as a painter, just like Sargent had done. So a few years later, Boldini, Ramon is going
to visit Boldini in his studio, and it kind of leads to the creation of this painting. This is a portrait of, it's called Portrait of the Young Super Queso, but we all think it's Pedro, the oldest. And it was really, this painting was never part of the Super Queso's family collection. I think it was intended to be a studio painting and a painting that Boldini would submit to exhibitions. It was shown in quite a few venues, and I really love it. I think it's wonderful. Just the way, again, another really honest recording of youth, the way he's kind of fidgeting with his stocking. Pedro would have been 11, 10 or 11, while he was sitting for this. So it's just, a really honest and accurate depiction of a 10-year-old boy, I think. There's this other Boldini that is kind of obscure that he did of Pedro. I don't remember any of them from around the same time. Just a sketch. So Ramon keeps traveling throughout the remainder of the 1880s and 1890s and keeps painting wherever he goes. And about that same time, I should say that the portrait of Pedro kind of leads to Eugenia commissioning, Eugenia and Jose Tomas commissioning this portrait of Eugenia from their oldest daughter, Carmen. And of course, the portrait of Eugenia is beautiful and kind of typical what you might expect from Boldini. But the portrait of their oldest daughter is the one that kind of stirred the pot. And I think you can see why. It really is kind of, it can be thought of almost as like a sequel, I think is a good word, to the portrait of Pedro from a few years earlier. From just 1 year earlier. And the portrait of Carmen was really actually a scandal wherever it was shown. Critics hated, basically, or were scandalized by everything about it, especially this little bit of skin that you can see at the top of her legs. And of course, she would be like 9 or 10 years old at the time she sat for this, and for it to be so kind of provocative. Was really weird. I think even today it's pretty weird. Sorry. And like I said, Ramon will keep painting along the way. It's kind of another portrait of Amalia. He kind of encourages Pedro to become a painter as well. Actually, I think they work on this painting together. They both sign it. It's like signed by R.E.P. Super Queso. But going back in time just a minute, I think my slides got out of order there. This is the last major portrait that the Super Quesos will commission of a major European artist. This is by Anders Zorn, who's a Swedish painter that's living in Paris. So think about this cast of characters that we've encountered just today is really, truly international. It's like the Chilean, the American painter, the Italian painter in Paris, the Swedish painter in Paris. So they have, because they're diplomat, because Ramon is a diplomat, and he's kind of traveling all over Europe, he has a really cosmopolitan group of friends, and Zorn will become one of them. This is a portrait of the youngest daughter, their youngest children, and I think, again, this is a really kind of unexpected portrait. It's like Zorn is kind of playing on the ground with the daughters, playing with them. And the fact that he leaves so much of the canvas blank with the rug, I think, is really kind of different, and at the time would have been really daring. But it's like he's down there, the little girl here is playing with the doll, and she's kind of coloring or playing with the book over here. And it's a really sweet and really kind of tender image. And that's something to keep in mind about the Super Quesos and the Arrozzarises, is they're both families. You know, they put a lot of emphasis on family and on their children. And if you go think about what you've seen today and kind of go through the show as well, you'll see several images of both families' children in the show. And I think there's, emphasis on that on childhood and maternity as continuing the family line. So after that painting is done that same year, Ramon will file his official report on kind of the state of the arts in Europe for the Chilean government, and he will suggest reforms to suggest kind of ideas of what can be done in Chile to raise the status of the arts in Chile in the way that, you know, kind of in a way that mirrors what's done in Europe. But they'll keep going back and forth between Chile and Europe, really pretty much until like the late into the 1920s. So here's Ramon and Amalia all dressed up. And I should say about Amalia that she is not just, you know, a diplomat's wife. She's kind of her own woman as well. She's a writer. She writes several books, one of which is about, it's called Roma del Alma, and it's about all of the churches that she visits while she's in Rome. She's an advocate for women's rights in Chile, which I think is really interesting. She's a very spiritual, the Supercasos are a very devout family, as well as the Aranzarizas, and she writes some kind of spiritual books as well. So she's a really interesting woman in her own right, and actually one of their daughters, Blanca, wrote a biography of her that I was able to get through interlibrary loan just for a short time throughout the planning of the show, and it's like, I can't find it anywhere to buy on the internet, so if you see it, let me know. And as I said, Ramon will serve as ambassador for the rest of his life in all different places in Europe, including Berlin. So this was taken in Berlin in 1901. And his kind of crowning achievement, I guess, as a diplomat is he will be the Chilean ambassador to the Vatican kind of toward the end of his career, which was a very important appointment for him. But all the while, he will keep painting. Like I said, he does these still lifes. I really like this painting as well. He's a good painter, and a lot of his work is in the collection of the National Museum of Fine Art in Santiago. And this little floral still life that Kevin and I saw when we went to Santiago in 2014. So this is still in a private family collection. So by the end of his life, this is a portrait of him toward the end of his life. He's respected as this great cultural ambassador for Chile and someone who really advanced the state of art in his home country, in Chile. And here he is. I found this photograph of him at the end of his life. And it still looks so much like he did when he was a young man. So like I said, his work is in the collection of the National Museum. And when Kevin, Marguerite, and I went to Santiago in 2014, that's what we get, always taking a selfie, we visited with family members who were really great and really supportive of the project, and had a great time getting to know them. The Supercaso family, the Ramon and Amalia's descendants, are still love art and are still diplomats. So those of you who came to the opening reception probably heard this man speak. That's Juan Gabriel Valdez, who is the current as in maybe one more day, Chilean ambassador to the United States. He's actually leaving his post, like, I think he's leaving Washington this weekend to go back to Chile. But he was able to come to the opening and had his picture made standing next to the portrait of his great-grandfather, which was it was really special, and it was a big honor for me personally, and I know for all of the Dixon, for him to come and kind of validate the show and have such nice things to say about it. So that was really special. So I hope we've all learned a little bit about the man in the bowler hat or the man in the gondola. And as you come back to the Dixon after the, hopefully you'll come back to see the show several times. Throughout the rest of, I think we have less than a month left to see it, that you'll, and even afterwards when you see the painting in the Dixon residence, you'll remember a little bit about who he was and his friendship, how his friendship with Sargent kind of led to some really, really beautiful works of art. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them, and I hope you'll kind of come peek at some of the books up here and see some more of Ramon's work.
gallery too, if you want.
When he went for like kind of the grand tour, which was like a very extended vacation, would have been 1874.
1874
when he went for the tour. Yes. I was going to say the painting, a couple of paintings were 1878. Oh, that Sargent painting from 1878. That was Sargent, something that Sargent, kind of like a painted sketch that Sargent had done before he even met Rameau, but he still had it. And either gave it to the Supercassos or they bought it from him.
It sounds really fortunate that he encountered Paris at the time of the Belle Epoque, the salons, I guess all the different artists sort of at the same time were appearing. But would you say that either Supercasso or Sargent, was there an influence of any other major painter on their own work, would you say? Or was each one their own man, so to speak?
You mean on each other?
No. That is, impressionist, there are elements that are stronger in one or the other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think Sargent definitely is not his own man. I think he's got influences from any number of artists, including the Impressionists and Edvard Manet. And Sargent's also, and really kind of like Rameau as well, I think he's really influenced by his travels. Sargent is, his whole life has been a constant traveler. His parents, that was their kind of life that they led. And Rameau travels a lot as well. So I think that's a big influence on both of them. Yeah. That's you.
So where was the salon? Where was that located? Because it looks like the Musée d'Orsay, but I think that was probably still the train station.
Yeah, it would have been at the time. I don't know where the salon of 1880, huh?
The Champ de Mars.
Yeah.
And the House of Industry.
Oh, okay. So that was a holdover from that 1800 exhibition? Or no, that couldn't have been.
I'm sorry, what was your question?
The exhibition that...
The salon?
Was that, where was
the salon had been held for a long time in Paris. I mean, like, at that point, probably 1880, like a couple of centuries. I think it starts in the late 1600s. So it had been this kind of annual exhibition that had been held in Paris every year. And it really kind of stays the place to have your work shown in Paris. Pretty much, by the end of the 1800s, it's kind of waning a little bit. But
so now, when they commissioned this artwork from these artists weren't yet completely well known, is that true? Or were they established already, like Zorn and the different...
Zorn is kind of known. I mean, they would have seen his work in at the 1891 salon. He had a painting called Omnibus that was shown there, and it was really kind of got a lot of buzz that year. One thing I didn't really say that is important to kind of keep in mind when you're going through the show is that both the Supercassos, the Arantzarises, and Eugenio's family, the Wiese family, are fabulously wealthy. They have a lot of money. They don't necessarily need to commission works of art from like starving artists.
So they would pay like a premium price to get this artwork, do you think? Or?
Well, they would work out the price with the artist. Yeah, and Sargent is like their age. And he's like, another thing to keep in mind too is that Sargent's like 24 when he paints that first portrait of Amalia. I mean, he's a young guy. They're all kind of young at that point. But as they go on a little bit, Boldini, by the time he meets the Supercassos, has kind of been in Paris for a little while. He's just getting going as being an important portraitist. And it's through the portraits that he does of the Chileans that are in Paris that really help establish his reputation as a portrait painter. Yeah. Kind of the same thing with Zorn.
Yeah. Where they were.
Right.
How can they lose track of the painting on that?
Yeah, it's not like
necessarily that they've been destroyed. It's just that people don't want their paintings to be known, I think, sometimes, too. I mean, they get in the, at one point, they're in the family's collection. And as time goes on, they go, things happen in families. Just like I was saying with the case of the reverse of the sergeant. People get divorced and there's bad, you know, or somebody dies and there might be a little bit of a squibble over who gets what in the estate. And I think that kind of happens. And it's sometimes like things, you have a list of who has owned something and then it kind of drops off the face of the earth sometimes. And then things will, you never know, things will resurface. And sometimes it seems, if you dig hard enough,